couldn't walk without you holding my hand. I thought number one would surely be me. I thought I would be what I wanted to be. I thought I would build on life's sinking sand, but I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I thought I could be a lot on my own. I thought I could make it all alone. I thought of myself as a mighty strong woman, but I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Oh yeah, the mountains too high and the valleys too wide. Down on my knees I learn to stand, because I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I think that I'll make Jesus my own. From now on, when I'm in trouble, I think on him I'll call. And if I don't trust him, I'd be less than a human, because I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountains too high and the valleys too wide. Down on my knees I learn to stand, because I can't even walk without you holding my
Amen. 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 That's a good song. Thank you for singing that for us this morning. If you're glad to be in the Lord's house, say hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, hallelujah is a heavenly word. We're going to use that word a lot in heaven. Amen. And we won't have to wear a mask. We won't have the virus. Amen. Last week where I preached, the guys that did the music right before I preached, they did a special music. They told the pastor they were going to sing two songs, and so after they got through, he jumped up And they said, oh, that was our first song. We did a medley. And so then they did a second song. So I told them, I'll tell you this morning, I promise you I won't preach a medley. Amen. But I am going to preach a different sermon in the 11 o'clock service. So if you want to stay around and get in on that, we'd love to have you. Brother Reuben, thank you for allowing Wendy and I to be here. Such a blessing always to be at Antioch. And we thank God for all that he's doing here. And in the midst of all the junk that's going on, we're hearing good reports from your pastor of people being saved. And we thank God for that. That's what it's all about. Amen or not? And so we thank the Lord for this church and the ministry, your pastor and the leadership. Thank you, Ross, for leading us today. If you will, take your Bible and turn to the book of Romans and find chapter 1. Romans chapter 1. And really, I really believe this is a word for this church for today. You know, sometimes, and I don't know if your pastor can agree with this or not, but sometimes I get up to preach and I feel like I've got a word from the Lord. I think I do, but sometimes you get up preaching, you know you do. Amen. And I really believe this is a word for this church, this congregation, this service on this Sunday morning. And I want to just talk to you for a few moments this morning about the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, John Wesley was used of God really to save the United Kingdom from tyranny and from really falling apart through sin and other things, and it was John Wesley that God used to preach the gospel that brought revival to England. But you know, for many years, John Wesley was trying to earn his way to heaven, was trying to work his way to heaven. Matter of fact, he sailed over to the United States and the colony of Georgia. He was going to be a missionary to the Indians, and while he was here, it was a terrible failure of a ministry. And he said to himself, he said, I'm here to save the Indians, but who's going to save me? Well, he got on a ship to go back to England. He was defeated. And he met some people called the Moravians who were sold out to Christ. And the reason that we don't know many of the names of the Moravian people, here was their motto, serve God and be forgotten. And many of them gave their life for the gospel. Well, while they were on that ship, John Wesley saw the exuberance and the joy these people had, and they invited him to come to a Bible study at Aldersgate there in England when they got home. And so reluctantly, John Wesley went, and he was sitting there, and someone was reading the preface of the commentary on Romans by Martin Luther. And just through reading the preface of that book, the Holy Spirit began to deal with John Wesley, and that night he gave his life to Christ. His testimony is, my heart was warmed, and I knew at that point my sins had been forgiven. And I want you to understand, Paul wrote a lot of books, but this is really many people say this was his masterpiece out of the 13 epistles that he wrote. And he deals with what Jesus' sacrifice on the cross has to do with us today, and how we walk in the Spirit and walk in the power of the gospel. You see, a lot of times we think about the gospel, we just think about, well, I got saved. Come on, amen. And let's get honest, all right? Let's get honest. Most of the time in a testimony meeting, when the pastor gets up and says, all right, who's got a testimony? Well, first of all, it's like crickets. And then the pastor says, well, anybody want to give a testimony? And then, you know, then the pastor will get desperate and he'll say, I'm going to count to three. And if nobody gives a testimony, we're going to move on. And finally somebody stands up and says, well, 197 years ago I got saved. Come on, amen. Well, hadn't God done something between then and now? Come on, somebody say amen. See, the gospel's not just for our salvation. The gospel is for us to live. Come on, amen. And I want you to read these verses. Look in Romans 1, 14 through 16. Paul says in these verses, I'm a debtor. Everybody say that out loud with me. I am a debtor. Say that with me. I am a debtor, both to Greeks and to barbarians, both to wise and to unwise. And look at verse 15. So as much as is in me, I am ready to preach the gospel to you who are in Rome also. And we all know verse 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. That word, unashamed, when we take the prefix off of it, the word ashamed is a picture of someone who's had a disfigured face and they hold their hands in front of it, not wanting anyone to see their scarred face. But Paul is saying, listen, I want you to see this gospel. I am not ashamed. Can I hear an amen? I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it is the power, the dunamis, of God to salvation. For everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also for the Greek. Now, I want to ask you a question. The Apostle Paul wrote this great epistle. But Paul wasn't always Paul, was he? Paul was Saul, amen or not. And Saul was that man who was persecuting the church, who was killing Christians, wreaking havoc in the church, the Bible says. And we all know his testimony in Acts chapter 9, and how he was on that road to Damascus, and God struck him down, and he began to have this conversation. He said, who are you, Lord? And then he asked another great question, what do you want me to do? And he goes into the city, and he meets this guy named Ananias. Ananias, man, that guy woke up that morning, the Holy Spirit said, I want you to go down to Damascus, and I want you to disciple this great preacher, Saul. What if the Lord woke you up in the morning about 3 o'clock and said, I want you to go pack a suitcase. We're over here to the Monroe Airport. And I'm talking to everybody. I'm talking about to grandmas and grandpas and young people. I'm talking about 18-year-olds to 90-year-olds. What if God told you to pack a suitcase, go over to the Monroe Airport or Shreveport Airport, get on a plane, fly to the Middle East. The leading terrorist was in a cave. He just got saved. And God wants you to go and disciple that person. You say, hallelujah, send Brother Reuben. Amen. Glory to God. And you remember what he told Saul? He said, Saul, you're going to be one of the greatest preachers the world's ever known, but you're going to suffer the rest of your life. You see, that's the Christian life. Can I hear an amen right there? You know, Paul said 30 years after he got saved, this isn't even in my notes, but it's blessing me. Amen. 30 years after Paul got saved, you remember what he wrote in Philippians? I want to know Jesus. I want to know Christ in the power of his resurrection and in the fellowship of his sufferings. How do you go from a Saul to a Paul? The gospel. What is the gospel? Well, 1 Corinthians 15, the first 4 verses define it for us. The Bible says Jesus was crucified. He died on the cross. For our what? Our sins, according to the scripture. He was buried. Why was Jesus buried? Because that's what you do with dead people. Amen. He didn't swoon. He didn't pass out. He died. He had to be sacrificed. On the third day, he rose again, according to the scripture. So what is the gospel? The death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus. Can I hear an amen right there? And through that gospel witness, through the fact that Jesus went to the cross for Saul's sin and Bill's sin, because he died, shed his blood, became our sacrifice, was buried, and rose again, and overcame death, hell, and the grave. That's why we're here this morning. Amen. The gospel. Now, what about this gospel? Now, can I just say something right here if I can say amen? And don't get mad at me because I'm going to be kind of hard on you this morning. Can I hear an amen? I just did a youth camp, Brother Reuben. I don't know how many hundreds of youth camps and D-nows and weekends and youth Sundays I've done since I started preaching. And you know, I used to get on these kids and I say, y'all ought to be more excited than anybody in here because of your youth and exuberance and your energy. But you know what? The Holy Spirit really spoke to me 2 weeks ago in that youth camp that I was preaching in and said, you know what? The young people don't have near as much to shout about as you old people. What has a 15-year-old kid gone through that matches what a 75-year-old, 80-year-old man or woman that's walked? Hallelujah! That's walked with Jesus all their life. We ought to be the ones up here jumping up and down. Come on, amen. We become a bunch of mossy back Baptists and say, well, I got saved 50 years ago and you'll get over it just like I did. Can I hear an amen this morning? Amen. No, I'm telling you, how many of you are over 60 years old? Let me see your hand up real high. We ought to be the ones shouting. We ought to be the ones out witnessing. We ought, come on, amen. And if you can't get out physically, we'll get you a laptop. We'll get you some emails. We'll get you some folks on the phone. We'll get you somebody to talk to about Jesus. Come on, amen. Listen, I'm getting fired up because I know what God's brought me through. There's been times I wanted to quit. There's been times we had more month at the end of the money than money at the end of the month. Can anybody say amen? There's been times I could tell you about in our ministry that we didn't have a dime, but yet we had $100,000 worth of needs, and God came through. Come on, amen. Can anybody shout with me this morning? Hey, we used to be shouting Baptists. Listen, the gospel is why we're here. The gospel is why we're saved. I want to give you three little thoughts, and I'm through. First of all, write this down in the margin of your Bible or on your bulletin or somewhere. First thing about this gospel, Paul says, is there's a debt that I owe. There's a debt that I owe. Paul said, I'm a debtor, both to the Greeks and the barbarians, both to the wise and the unwise. You see, Paul said, I owe a debt. I'm under this obligation. I must share the gospel. I must live for Jesus because I am a debtor. Can anybody say amen? Now, obviously, number one, we're a debtor to Jesus. You know, I tell you, a lot of older people, you know, they've served, they've taught Sunday school, they've worked in the nursery, they've driven church buses and vans, they've brought casseroles to the church, they've ministered to the bereaved, they've gone visit hospitals, and then we get a little older, and the pastor says, would you do this? And I've heard senior adult people say this in church, well, pastor, I paid my dues. I didn't know you could pay God off. They asked an old preacher the other day, he said, man, when are you going to slow down? You're supposed to slow down when you get older. He said, slow down. He said, I thought when you saw the finish line, you're supposed to speed up. Come on, amen. We owe a debt to Jesus. Now, there's no way we could ever repay him, is it? No way. We could live 100 lives and live as close to him as possible and never repay what he did on the cross. But honey, we ought to live like we want to and we could. Come on, amen. You know, since this coronavirus hit, you know, churches have been shut and we've had online services, and I've done a few of those for pastors through the months. Now that our churches are beginning to open back up and we're having some semblance of gathering again, you know, doing it differently, but yet we're together like we are this morning. You know, really, I've been a little disappointed, Brother Reuben. I thought that when our churches opened the doors again, we'd have to have the sheriff's department out on the highway directed traffic because so many people would be hungry to get back to God's house. But yet, I think a lot of folks have just gotten used to sitting at home in their pajamas, eating pancakes, sipping coffee, and really not even paying attention. Come on, somebody say amen. Doesn't Jesus deserve more than that? Is Jesus worth us? Is he worth us coming to God's house and reading his word and praying? Listen, we've got brothers and sisters. I just put on Facebook early this morning, just got a report of one of our recent graduates of our Bible college in India. You know, and through your support, we're able to do stuff like this. And this guy has gone up to a state right on the Pakistani border. And man, it's a hard place. It's a difficult place. I'm not even sure he's going to make it. Is Jesus worth it? You know what will keep 17 Baptists from coming to church? 16 drops of rain. Is anybody listening to what I'm saying? We owe a debt to Jesus. Amen. We ought to be in his house. Amen. It ought to be a joy when the pastor says it's time to take the offering. Amen. We ought to be hungry just like we are for bacon and eggs to open up the Bible every morning and get a fresh word from heaven through the word of God. To spend time praying. Man, it ought to be a joy to share the good news of what Jesus has. Come on, somebody say amen. But I'll tell you something else. Not only do we owe a debt to the Savior, we owe a debt to the saints. Brother Reuben, you and I, we owe a debt to these men of God that have gone before us, that poured into our lives, that, that blessed us and encouraged us. I know, like Brother Paul and others, Brother Jeff that you talk about, that have ministered to you through the years. Brother Prothro was my pastor growing up. And I think about Brother Ed Smith, who has been a mentor of mine. And I can name a dozen others that have poured into my life. People have given us money to go around. Listen, I owe a debt to the saints. I owe a debt to my mom and dad, who brought me up to love the Word of God and took me to God's house. And I used to hear my dad and mom sing, and I saw them put money in there. Listen, I owe a debt to you, because what you've done before me and how you're... Listen, I want to tell you something. We owe a debt to those that have ministered. Come on, somebody say amen. I ought to live holy right now, and I ought to live for God, and I ought to be hungry for God, because I owe a debt to the saints. Listen to me. Two times in the Word of God, one time in Acts chapter 7 and one time in Acts chapter 22, it's recorded that when Paul, before he became Paul, when he was still Saul, he was killing Christians. You know what? One day they stoned this guy named Stephen, and guess who was there? Saul of Tarsus, holding Stephen's clothes. Listen, he was there when that hole opened up in heaven. And the Bible says Jesus was standing at the right hand of God. Don't you know that that had an impact on Saul? And I believe this. Somebody asked me one time, said, who's the greatest Christian you believe in the Bible? Who was the greatest Christian? We would all say the Apostle Paul, but I want to say I don't know if it was the Apostle Paul. I think it might have been Stephen, because I believe it was through Stephen's sacrifice and his death and his standing for the gospel is how the Holy Spirit began to deal with Saul, who became Paul, who wrote 2/3 of the... Is anybody hearing me right here? Paul said, I owe a debt. But I'll tell you something else, and really here's our text. We owe a debt to the Savior, we owe a debt to the saints, but we owe a debt to the sinners. We've had friends that have died because of the virus and others that are sick. Thank God for the millions that have recovered. Amen. And, there's a lot of controversy over will certain drugs cure the coronavirus. But let's just suppose this morning. Y'all with me? If you are, say amen. Let's just put on our sanctified imaginations for a minute this morning. Let's just suppose that you were in the hospital. And you were dying for whatever, some disease, just some disease. No hope. Doctor said nothing. We have no medicine. There's no surgery. Nothing could save your life. But I knew there was a cure. Matter of fact, I had it in a bottle in my pocket. And I came by to see you in the hospital. And there you are dying. And we talk about hunting and fishing and the weather. And politics, and sports. And I say, well, sorry you're sick, God bless you. And I left with a cure in my pocket. Let me tell you something. When we think about immorality, we think about sexual sin, but that would be immoral. But how many times we that have known the gospel for 20, 30, 40, 50 years walk out of a store, go to visit someone in their home that we know that's lost, and we never, ever mention Jesus Christ to them. You see, Paul, it's getting quiet in here now. Come on, amen. I don't care if you're 8 years old or 89 years old in this building this morning, we all owe a debt to everyone that's lost that they might know Christ. Come on, amen. We just took off a few days, went up to Hot Springs, Arkansas, and a couple from Oklahoma, some friends of ours met us there. We had a good just time of relaxing for the last few days. And matter of fact, I don't have the virus and I don't have leprosy. I'm just peeling from being out in the sun. Amen. And we went into a restaurant one morning to have breakfast. It was the first night we were there. We went to this restaurant to have dinner. And I began to talk to this waitress about the Lord. And I want to tell you something. Her whole attitude changed. And come to find out, she was a believer. But I want you to understand something. We have an obligation, no matter where we are, no matter what the situation, even if it would come to the point of losing our physical lives, we owe a debt to those without Christ. I don't know why, but Wendy and I were in two different vehicles for some reason. It was 1 o'clock in the morning. We were in Manny, Louisiana, just passing through. We both needed fuel for our automobiles. And so we pull in this little convenience store, gas station. It's 1 a.m. And you can ask Wendy, I go to a lot of stores and there won't be one person there. And then when I get in there, there'll be 20 people show up just like that. I don't understand it. But I pulled in there. There was maybe one other person in there. I went to the restroom, came out, and there was about 15, 20 people in that store. I told Wendy, I told her, just stay in the car. I'd bring her something to drink. And so there's a line of people. Now, I was there, you know, to pay for my stuff. And man, you could smell the alcohol on these guys and the drugs. And man, there was vulgarities. And there were some guys that came in. I don't know if it was a gang-related thing, but man, it was just kind of tense in there. And so the guy that was standing in front of me, he looked at the door when this guy walked in. And the guy that walked in said to the man in front of me, he said, man, what you doing here? And here's what the guy said in front of me. I'm just trying to find a little mercy. I said, excuse me, sir. I know exactly where you can find it. He said, where's that? I said, on a cross over 2,000 years ago when Jesus bled and died for your sin and my sin, and he gave us mercy. Can I hear an amen from the church? And I want to tell you something. The whole atmosphere of that convenience store changed, and the glory of God came in. Hey, you want to change the atmosphere of our nation? Hey, we got to quit watching Fox News and CNN and get in the Word of God and get full of the Holy Ghost and quit living in fear and start walking in the power of the Holy Spirit, because that's the only change that's the only thing that's going to change the United States of America. Paul said, when it comes to the gospel, there's a debt that I owe. Can I hear an amen from the church? But second of all, he says, here's the reason that I go. Look at verse 15. Boy, this is good right here. You just have to read this over and over and let it get into your heart and mind and spirit. But it says, so as much as is in me. In other words, Paul says, there's nothing lacking. Everything about me, everything that's in me is ready to preach the gospel to you who are at Rome also. The word ready, it means eager. Paul says, I'm eager. I'm like a hungry dog. I'm eager to share the gospel. It means to be ready-minded. Now, the Greek word, it gives us a picture of beforehand or to be predisposed. And it means to be predisposed with a passion, watch this, or a fierceness. So Paul says, I'm ready. I've got this predisposed passion and fierceness about me to share the gospel. Can I hear an amen right there? Here's the picture. It's a picture of an athlete working and preparing and sweating and breathing hard, getting ready for the upcoming competition. I don't know about you, but I love to watch the Olympic Games, especially the Summer Olympics. I love to watch the Olympic Games. But you know what? To be an athlete and to contend in the Olympic Games, you don't sit around and eat ding-dongs all day long. Can I hear an amen? Your diet does not consist of Twinkies and Coca-Cola. These men and women have been on a strict diet. They sleep a certain number of hours every night. They work out a certain number of hours every day. They're in the gym, or they're on the track, or whatever they are, in the swimming pool, whatever their sporting competition is. You see, they're fierce about it. They're hungry. They're working. They're breathing hard. They're ready. Come on, amen. Y'all with me? So when they go into that competition, they're ready to go. Now, Paul says, first of all, I'm ready as a messenger. Notice what he says. So far as it depends on me, I am ready to share the gospel. You've heard preachers say this before, but I want to ask it again. What if the evangelistic outreach of Antioch Baptist Church depended on you? What if everybody in Antioch Baptist Church witnessed like you do? What if everybody in Antioch Baptist Church prayed for the lost like you do? Now, if I get sick, I want everybody at this church praying for me. If I'm in the hospital, I want you praying for me. But I'm going to be honest with you. I look at most churches' prayer lists. They'll have 100 sick people on it. They'll have very few, if any, lost people on it. We spend more time praying folks out of heaven than we do praying folks out of hell. What if everybody wept over souls like you do? You see, Paul says, as far as I'm concerned, I'm ready. I'm ready. But then he said, not only does it have to do with a messenger, but the message. I'm ready to do what? Look at verse 15 again. To preach the gospel to you. To announce the good news. To declare. To evangelize. See, Rome was a cesspool of iniquity, man. It was a filthy sewer, one reporter said. I mean, it was just like our nation today. I mean, nothing seems to be sin anymore. It's wicked and ungodly. And I'll tell you... And listen to my heart this morning, folks. A lot of times, let's just be honest, we'll look at a person in a certain lifestyle and we'll say, man, they deserve to go to hell. Everybody in here deserves to go to hell. He said, I'm ready to preach the gospel. And right in that cesspool of iniquity, Paul says, listen, I'm not only is the messenger ready, but the message is ready. The gospel is never going to be outdated. The gospel does not have an expiration date on it. Come on, amen. You say, well, you're an evangelist. You know, Brother Reuben's a pastor. Listen, there's all kind of opportunities to win. You don't have to be in the ministry to be a soul winner. Man, I've had all kind of opportunities to witness outside the four walls of the church. I mean, just handed to me on a silver platter. For instance, I was in Dillard's one time buying my wife some perfume, cologne, whatever you ladies call it. And this lady walks up beside me and she asked the clerk, she said, may I smell eternity? I thought, Merry Christmas, amen. I said, ma'am, that's an interesting question. Do you know that eternity has two fragrances? She said, no, I wasn't aware of that. What are they? I said, heaven and hell. Come on, amen. What a witness opportunity. Amen or not? I was in a store one day, and these two Mormon guys, they had this girl cornered. They were talking to her about Mormonism and all that heresy. And so I just went up and put my arms around both those Mormon guys, and they said, excuse me, what's going on? I said, well, I heard you talking to this lady about your religion. I said, you know, I'm a lot like you two guys, but I'm different. And they said, well, how are you alike us? And I said, well, I go all over the world telling people about Jesus. They said, well, how are you different? I said, I tell them about the real Jesus. Come on, amen. Is anybody getting anything out of what I'm saying? All kind of opportunities to share the gospel. God sends them to you right there on a silver plate. A good friend of mine, mutual friend of your pastor, we were both in a revival down in Alexandria, Louisiana at two different churches, and after the services at night, we would meet at IHOP. We would drink coffee and catch up, fellowship. And so this lady, the hostess, she sat us down at our table, and this big, tall, skinny dude came up to bring us water and take our order, and I got to sharing Jesus with him, Brother Reuben. He got so nervous, he got so under conviction, he couldn't even serve us water without spilling it on the table, and I knew the Spirit of God was moving, and so then this lady that was seated us, the hostess, she came over to me, and she said, are you a preacher? And I said, yes, I am. I said, matter of fact, both of us are preachers, and she said, well, I need to talk to y'all, and so she would seat people and come over and talk to us, and come to find out that she was living in sin, and God began to deal with her, and she knew she needed to get right with God, and right in the middle of this big, tall, skinny dude getting under conviction, and the hostess knowing that she needed the Lord, this girl grabs her boyfriend and drags him over there. He's got blood on his arms, and she said, this guy is my boyfriend. He was in a wreck tonight. He'd have gone to hell. He needs to listen. I told the church the next night, I said, we had more Holy Ghost at IHOP the last night than we've had here the last three nights. Come on, amen. You know why? Because of the gospel. Is anybody getting anything out of what I'm saying? The gospel, there's a debt that I owe. The reason that I go is the world's lost without Christ. They need a message, and God uses us as the messenger. But here's my third point. Y'all still with me? If you are, say amen. Not only do we see the debt that we owe and the seed that we sow, or yeah, the seed that we sow, or the reason that we go. I'm getting all messed up here. The third thing is the message that we sow. Look at Romans 1:16. We've seen the debt that we owe, the reason we go. Now here's the message that we sow. Look at verse 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it's the power of God to salvation for everyone. Everybody say everyone. Doesn't matter who they are. Amen. Think about somebody in your parish. You feel like, well, man, it'd be a miracle if they got saved. Well, let me tell you something. If God can save you and me, he can save anybody. But listen, to everyone, God wants to save everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also to the Greek. Now, this is interesting to me. We see the presentation of the gospel, and it's this. In Romans 1:1, you don't have to read these verses. You can read them later. But in Romans 1:1, the Bible calls it the gospel of God. But then in Romans 1:9, the Bible says it's the gospel of his son, the gospel of Jesus Christ. And then in Romans chapter 1:16 says it's the gospel of Christ. So it's the gospel of God, the gospel of his son, and the gospel of Christ. Now, why in the world did the Holy Spirit have Paul write it that way? Well, it's the gospel of God because salvation comes from him. Amen. Hey, you know this, but I want to remind you, because I never take for granted that everybody in any service is saved. And you might be 8, you might be 18, you might be 90. I don't take it for granted that anybody's saved. I want to tell you something, ladies and gentlemen. Salvation originates from heaven with God. It's not a Baptist deal. I've had people tell me, well, I don't believe you get saved the Baptist way. I don't either. You say, well, I believe you get saved the Pentecostal way. No, it's not a Baptist thing, Catholic thing, Pentecostal thing, apostolic thing. It's not a Church of Christ thing. It's all about Jesus. Come on, amen. And salvation came from heaven. It was in God's heart before the foundation of the world to send his son to die for us. So it doesn't originate with a Baptist, it originates with God. So it's the gospel of God. And this is the gospel of his son, because the gospel was brought to us by the Son of God. That baby that was born of a virgin, come on, amen or not? Wrapped in swaddling clothes, that grew up, lived a sinless life. He was a perfect Lamb of God who laid his life. Listen, the way this gospel was brought to heaven to us was by Jesus. And it's the gospel of Christ because he was the anointed one who died and lives again. Aren't you glad Jesus didn't come to live and to die, but he came to die and live again. Amen. It's the presentation of this gospel. It came from God. It was brought to us by Jesus. It was taken care of through Christ, the anointed one, the Messiah, who was the promised one who would come to die for us. And then Paul gives us the power of the gospel. Watch this. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it's the power of God to salvation. Now, the word power is the word dunamis, and where we get our word dynamite. Now, let me ask you something. If I strap three sticks of dynamite together, and I know what a beautiful renovation y'all have done here at the church, but let's suppose I take three sticks of dynamite together, laid them on the floor, on the steps of this altar, and lit the fuse, and they blew up. You know what? It changed the scenery. How many of you know the gospel of Christ can't go off inside of you without changing you? I like what one preacher says, if you are what you was, you ain't. Come on, amen. If you're still the same as you always have been, you've never experienced this gospel. I was a teenage boy when I got saved. I was in high school, gave my life to Christ, and I want to tell you, everything changed, Brother Reuben. Man, all of a sudden, I got this hunger for God's word like I never had. The pastor, listen, if Brother Prothero was still alive, you could ask him. He turned the lights off on me on Sunday night, gave me to go home. Then I'd follow him home. I'm not lying to you. Then I'd go home, sit at his bar, and I'd eat Oreo cookies with him, and we'd talk. Come on, somebody say amen. I immediately got a burden for my high school. Next morning, I got saved on Tuesday night. Wednesday morning, I went down to the football locker room, put a sign up, if you want to get saved, see Bill Britt. One of my teachers asked me to sit on his desk and tell the class what the gospel meant, what it meant to be born again. He said, I don't understand all that. And I preached my first sermon. Everything changed. You see, when the gospel goes off in you, it's the dynamite, it's the power of, come on, amen. And then the Bible says we're to take this gospel to the people of the world, no matter who they are, no matter what their skin color is, no matter what side of the tracks they live on, no matter what lifestyle they're living in, we take this gospel to everyone. And the purpose is, watch this, verse 17, For in the gospel, we find the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, and is written, the just shall live by faith. Come on, amen. How many of you know you can't go to heaven unless you're perfect? And the only way you're going to be made perfect is to have the imputed righteousness of Christ put on you and given to you. And ladies and gentlemen, I want to tell you, 60 times Paul uses this word righteous in some form in the book of Romans, 60 different times, and it means to be perfectly conformed to God's law and holy character. How in the name of heaven can we ever attain that? It has to be through what Jesus did at the cross, the gospel. Come on, amen. The gospel. Hudson Taylor was a powerful missionary who went to China. I think he buried two wives there and buried some children. He sacrificed a lot to take the gospel to the Chinese. And someone asked him one time, they said, boy, you must really love the Chinese. And here's what Hudson Taylor said. He said, I did not take the gospel to the Chinese because I love the Chinese. I took the gospel to the Chinese because I love God. And therefore, I love the Chinese. So let me make an observation from that testimony. If we don't have a burden for souls, if we don't have a hunger to share the gospel, maybe it's that we don't love God. Because when you get saved, you love what God loves. And God loves people. Come on, amen. Years ago in our crusades, we used to sing a song. Gary Robinson used to travel with me, very talented musician, and we would sing this song, God loves people more than anything. God loves people more than anything. More than anything, he wants you to know. He gave his life to tell you so. God loves people more than anything. You see, Jesus told the Pharisees one day, the reason you're not worried about people going to heaven is because you're not going to heaven. Amen. Now, let me finish this up and I'm done. Why aren't we ready to share this gospel? Why aren't we eager? Well, there's several applications we could get. Number one, maybe we don't know Jesus. It's hard to introduce Jesus to somebody if you don't know Jesus. Y'all with me? Come on, amen. Maybe we just don't, maybe we're good people. Maybe we're good Baptist people. Maybe we're moral people. Maybe we're good citizens. Maybe we're great next door neighbors. Maybe we're just good folks that come to church and help our neighbors, but really don't know Christ. Or if we are saved, maybe there's sin that's quenching and grieving the Holy Spirit in our life. Maybe it's unforgiveness. Maybe you hate people. So I don't hate people. Let me tell you how I know a lot of Baptist people hate people. You bring up certain people in lifestyles, or you talk about certain people with certain skin color, or you talk about Muslims or somebody, and I'm telling you, well, I hate those people. Look what they, listen, Christian people don't have that kind of attitude when they're walking in the Spirit. You can't win somebody to Jesus you hate. Come on, amen. I'm going to be honest. I have to walk in the Spirit to see Nancy Pelosi on TV. And Schiff. But you know what? Jesus died for Nancy Pelosi. Come on, somebody help me right here. Jesus died for those Muslims that blew up the Twin Towers. I went to Pakistan a few years ago where I thought I was nuts. I never felt so big, so slow, and so American in all my life. Amen. Stood up in a field, 6,000 Muslims looking at me, holding the Bible, preaching the gospel. You know what? Over 4,300 recorded professions of faith were made in 4 nights. I said 4,300 people got saved. That'd be a pretty good Sunday, wouldn't it? Come on, amen. Be a pretty good revival. Maybe, here's another observation. Maybe we're just ashamed of Jesus. Huh? Maybe we're afraid that somebody's going to shut the door in our face or spit at us or cuss us. And I doubt very seriously in Union Parish everybody's going to kill you for sharing the gospel. But you know, we're afraid, you know, and it might hurt our faith. Listen, your reputation's not on the line, sir, ma'am. Lost souls are on the line, not your reputation. Let me ask you something. Number one, are you born again? I'm talking about every one of us. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 13, examine yourself to see whether you be in the faith. And that starts from the pulpit to the back row. Examine ourselves to see whether we're in the faith. Did I just make a profession of faith? Did I just walk down the aisle? Did I just get dunked in a Baptist stream? Or did I really meet Jesus? Did the gospel of Christ come alive on the inside of me? Are you really born again? You say, well, man, I'm a good woman. I'm a good man. I've been faithful to my spouse. I've raised my kids right. I worked hard. I paid my bill. No, those are great things, and we ought to all have that testimony. But here's what, have you been born again? Come on, amen, born again. Examine your heart right now. Now, I don't know what you believe, but I believe Jesus could come back right now. How about you? Are you ready? Listen, I'm a grandpa. I got 6 grandkids. You know, man, if I didn't have a little gel in my hair, it'd be like a snow on the mountain. Come on, amen. You know, one of the greatest mission fields in America are nursing homes. I preached in nursing homes and had 90-year-old people roll up in their wheelchair, weeping, lost. Been good, faithful church members all their life. Examine yourself. Second of all, are you filled with the Spirit? If you're not sharing the gospel, you're not filled with the Spirit. Now, I made this statement here recently, and I'm going to say it again. The problem in Louisiana is we got a bunch of good churches, but we don't have many Spirit-filled churches. Oh, that's a good man. That's a good woman. Well, wonderful. But here's what we need. We need Spirit-filled women and Spirit-filled men. Are you full of the Holy Spirit? Or let me ask you, are you just embarrassed, a little ashamed? You know, I carry tracts everywhere I go, and I try to pass out these little tracts everywhere I go. You know, it doesn't take a whole lot of energy just to reach in your pocket or your purse and pull out a little piece of paper that has the gospel on it and say, here, honey, Jesus loves you. Sir, Jesus loves you. And you know what? You could take that tract, leave it with them. They can read it, and the Holy Ghost can change their life. One guy said, I know why y'all call it a track now. He said, a guy gave me one at work. It tracked me home. It tracked me to bed. It tracked me up the next morning. Tracked me back to work till I got saved. Come on, amen. Now, let me put something in your heart. I don't even know what time it is. My watch broke. Let me ask you something. Who loves your family more than you do? Nobody. So family members are the hardest to witness to. You know why? Because they know us the best. They know all the warts and junk. Come on, amen. They've seen us lose our temper, and they've seen, you know, heard us say things that aren't. But you know what? Here's what you do. You just go to your family member, you go to your next door neighbor, whoever you're blown it with, and say, you know what? I'm a Christian. Man, I hadn't been walking in the Spirit, and I want you to forgive me. And I want to tell you that Jesus loves you, and I don't want to be a stumbling block for you to go to hell. I want to be a stepping stone for you to go to heaven and give them Jesus. Come on, amen or not. Don't be ashamed. I've had to go to people before and say, forgive me for my attitude, forgive me for my anger, forgive me for this or that, and I want to tell you about Christ. I've had to swallow my pride. So Paul says, I'm ready. Are you ready? When you leave here today, how many, listen, most of you have a cell phone. Come on, amen. And if you don't have a smartphone, you got a flip phone. Let me tell you what happened at our youth camp this past week, and I'm done. We had two sessions every night. We had a session, then we had breakout groups, then we had some games and stuff, a little refreshment time, and then we had another service. One night, the first service was over. At the end of that service, we challenged the young people. Listen to this. We challenged the young people to get on their phones and start texting and calling their friends during the break before the second service and tell their friends to get down to the church where we were having our service because they loved them and they wanted them to be there. And you know what? We had about 10 young people show up because those kids called their friends and five of them got saved. If you don't know how to do anything else, do what one guy did. He got saved on his way home. He stopped by his buddy's house he knew was lost. He was already in the bed. He dragged him out of the bed, put him in a chair in the middle of the living room, and started walking around him. And his friend said, "What's wrong with you? You crazy?" He said, "No, I got saved tonight." And he said, "The preacher talked about this city named Jericho, and they marched around it seven times before the walls fell in, and I'm going to keep marching around you till you get saved." One guy just went to his buddy's house. He was watching a football game on Monday night. He just pulled a chair up, sat right in front of his recliner. He said, "What you doing?" He said, "I'm going to sit here till you get saved." He said, "That's silly." No. Those guys were going to hell. What's silly about that? So do you know Christ today? Do you know the Lord? Are you walking in the Spirit? Do you have a burden and a passion for souls? Are you ashamed? Paul also wrote the book of 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7. "For God's not given us a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and a sound mind." Can I hear an amen? Amen. And that word fear is the word timidity. We can be bold as lions. Come on, amen. They said, "Bill, you have to quit going to some of these places. They're going to kill you. What are they going to do, send me to heaven?" We sing, "This world's not my home. I'm just passing through." And then we cling to it. Come on, amen. Now, I'm not going to jump out in front of a Mack truck this afternoon on I-20, but I want to tell you something. Friends, if living for Jesus brings me to dying for Jesus, so be it. So be it. Let's pray. I'm going to ask our friends to come. We're going to have an invitation. I know we're social distancing and all that, but there's plenty of room. You can just come and sit on these front rows, 6 feet apart from each other. You can make that your altar. And I'm going to ask people to move in this early service. Make a public decision openly this morning for several things. And here's the first thing. While our sister begins to play there at the piano, here's the first thing. Are you saved? So let me ask you a question from the front row to the back row, sound booth. How many of you in this room this morning would say, "Bill, if I died today, if Jesus Christ came back today, I don't hope I'm saved. I don't think I'm saved. Buddy, I know that I'm saved. If Jesus came back in 30 minutes, if I died taking my afternoon nap, I know I'm going to be with the Lord." Can I just see your hand up real high all over this room? God bless you.